Come on! Ant deserves in this game. They got two goals full of I do not curse lightly on this channel.
What up, my fellow kids? Zealand attire down in the description, available for purchase. Very comfortable. Very nice.
Okay, this is... No. Ooh. All right, we're ready to talk about set pieces, which we've been putting off for a long time. Now, the reason for that is what you just saw. Not the hair and the hoodie and the merch stuff, but me giving up, I think it's a couple of goals on set pieces, even though I have been doing extensive research about how to prevent such things. Set pieces are even more of a lottery than the rest of Football Manager. The ball's flying around quickly. Sometimes somebody just doesn't have it mentally today, or the matchup just happens to be perfectly wrong for you, or it can be perfectly right for you. But the ball flying around in tight quarters right next to the mouth of the goal usually leads to a lot of drama and inexplicable happenings, and it is honestly impossible to prevent all of that. But what you can do in these situations is put yourself in the best position to succeed, the same as the rest of Football Manager, and that's what we're trying to do here. Me losing my mind is funny, though, and if you want to watch me do that more often, I stream Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday at 11 a.m. New York time, 4 p.m. London time. You can check that out at the description down below. Give it a follow on Twitch and join me.
Join me.
But you, in your intelligence and high-mindedness, are sitting there thinking, gee, what are set pieces? Let's start defending corners. Now, with every tactical side of Football Manager, you are going to want to tailor it to the talent you have as a team. Now, one of the downsides that I have at Bate Borisov is that I do not have a brilliant aerial team. I play with a high line. I play with athleticism. I play with energy. So if a player is tall anywhere on my team, including center back, it is a byproduct. It's not what I signed them for. And that's something that can hurt me when it comes to corners. So what you will notice is I have nobody threatening. I wouldn't recommend ever taking everybody into the box itself, but this opportunity to run on the edge of the box is absolutely lethal. It has been for multiple match engines. When the ball falls to them at the edge of the box, if you've got somebody that has good dribbling or good athleticism, or hopefully both, and some creativity, they can take off and just completely change the field. And you maybe get a corner, get the ball out for a throw-in, or just make a bunch of plays and go down and score if they're cool enough. As for who to put in these situations, I typically like to put my two best aerial defenders on the front and the back post with the zone marking scheme, because that is where the computer is just going to like to attack the most. I try and put someone with decent height in between the two, and so you don't have to keep going in and out of this screen. It all pops up over here in the important attributes section on the right. I put my shortest two people on the post, my most creative player running with the ball, lurking outside the area, and then I have the other four go back. Now that is just me. Feel free to experiment with it. I have seen people that have gone with five in the zone marking. I think that leaves you too exposed in this space. I do understand and used to practice putting three decently tall people here, and having a couple of man-marked talls that would follow around the tallest players, but I felt like sometimes that would lead to us marking the same person twice, because that person would be running the front post or the back post, and they would also be marked by somebody else, leaving another player completely unmarked. But if you've got some people that are really good in the air and you feel like you're going to be able to win a lot of those headers, they are brave, they have good jumping reach, they have good heading, and you can take these people off the post, go ahead and stick one or two people up at the top and play it out any way you want, really. I know that's not what you wanted to hear, but that's kind of why I put off making this video. I mean, it's so dependent on how your team is, how good your goalkeeper is at coming out, how good your top defenders in corner situations are at preventing people from getting headers. I like the zone marking because it locks my people into a spot where the most headed goals come from. I was using zone marking in that match where I gave up two goals off of corners, but typically I end up near the top of the league in goals scored and the bottom of the league in goals allowed, not just in Bate, but with Dortmund too, from corners. So it does do a bit to take away the obvious chances, which I guess is really all you can hope for. I just hate giving up goals off corners, so that's why I everybody back, please. Remember, you got to set this on both sides. The good news is that once you get something set, you can save the routine. And once you get all of your routines set for an entire tactic, you can save all routines, which means if you get it set for one tactic, you can load them up on other tactics. And with some very small tweaking, it should match your starting 11, because obviously tactics are going to have different specific positions, depending on which one they are. But you do have up to 3 routine spots that you could train, so I would recommend, and I have not done this, this is an oversight on my part, I would recommend creating your more offensive tactic, where you've got 1 or 2 people up here, or more offensive routine, and then you drag somebody to the top of the box, and then you save that as routine number 2 on the right, save it as routine number 2 on the left, and get it all set at the beginning of the season. That's when I set all of this up. It's just easy. You set it up at the beginning of the season, and you can tweak it as the season goes on, and check it before big matches. That's important. Now, like normal tactical decisions, every once in a while, somebody will stumble across a completely game-breaking tactic. But the good thing about completely rewriting the marking engine in Football Manager 20, even though it's something that has annoyed me sometimes, come on, is that it cannot be completely game broken, right? There's no set piece tactic that's just smashing in goals at an ungodly rate. So this is again going to be dependent on who is your feature player in this situation. In FM19, I was managing Carmarthen Town, and I really dove into set pieces for the first time on my own. And I noticed that I had a center back that was 5'9". The name was Chris Sion. Why do I remember that? I realized I had no real aerial threat. I mean, the Welsh League's a bunch of big physical guys, right? I had no real aerial threat. So I decided I was going to play the ball short every time, and I was going to put my best guy on long shots on the edge of the box. And you know what? He scored 7 times because of that routine, the guy on the edge of the box. But a guy taking... I told my taker to take it short every time. And he would pass it to the guy on the edge of the box, who would then shoot, and he scored 7 different times throughout the course of the season from that. And if I'd taken another tactic that I'm going to recommend, if you've got a great tall guy or 2 great tall guys to try and score, I would have scored less goals from my corner routine than that. Always keep that in mind. There is no wrong answer except for the obviously wrong answers. But I'll break this into 3 parts. You've got your 1, which is when you don't have anybody tall. You realize you have no significant threats in the box, and you want to put somebody short. And the person you want to put short should be good at crossing. They should be technical, right? They're either going to run up to the edge of the box and play a ball in, or they're going to keep it moving to somebody that you have lurking outside the area right here. And you want them to typically have an in-swinging foot. It's going to be more difficult for them to hook up a great pass from this corner. So this guy, Ayrton Lucas, he's got a right foot. Rojas. I don't even know my own team. I'm so sorry, Ayrton. Give him an in-swinging foot. Then you give this person, lurking on the edge of the box, probably a strong left foot, which I believe Abdullah Zaki does not have. I don't know if I have a left-footed player with good long shots anywhere. Ramiro? That works. You'd set him up out here. You'd set everything else up normally. You definitely want somebody marking the keeper to try and make things more interesting for him. And you just try and play it short. Say, hey, knock it short. This obviously means it does not matter who is taking your corner. Anyways, you probably want somebody that's good in short quarter situations, so that they can play off of this short corner receiver. Also probably good crossing, but obviously you wish they had 20 at every attribute. So that's option 1. Option 2 I'll give you is a little bit different. This is locking in on one person that you know is good. So if you've got, say, let's say Ladislav Kostolanski, he's got incredible bravery. He's got excellent decision making. He's big, but his heading's not brilliant. If he had 17 heading, Ladislav Kostolanski is that dude. I think I've actually got somebody who would qualify as that dude. Denis Kozlov's not quite tall enough, but we'll pretend that he has like 16 jumping reach and just a little bit better everything. I'm going to thump this ball to him every time. Now, what else would you think I would need to do to give him the best chance? So pass to the near post. He's attacking the near post. I'm going to put somebody who's tall right here, but I want to have somebody that is lurking in the near post. I want to have somebody marking the keeper. I want to make this absolutely hectic. I want to distract the markers, right? So I'm going to have a couple of different people running at different posts so that this is all going to open up for Kozlov, and I'm just going to pump the ball to him, right? That's the focused approach. You can even put somebody short because sometimes this will draw a defender. Don't put a center back typically short, but you take this guy, stick him over here, and another defender will get drawn. anything to create space for Kozlov. Then there's option three, which is the option that I go for. I've got a couple of people that are pretty darn good in the air. They're not great, but they're pretty good. I've got Kozlov and I've got Kostolansky, who I have somehow lost. We got him. And then I've got this weird player, Agazadé, who is really tall and really athletic. He's fast, man, really fast. And so I just have him charge off the edge of the box just because. I leave only one person back, right? When I have a team that I'm confident is better, I think one person's going to be able to stop it up, and I score more goals than I give up from this situation. So I think the time that I've been doing this, I've given up 3 goals being countered off a corner. It's been 2 years, so that's a pretty good record. Most people will recommend 2, and if you're a worse team, I recommend having 2 people back to make sure that counterattack doesn't get going, because they can get behind these midfielders at some point with some bad deflection or something. Then I have near post, far post, and mark the keeper. So I've got a couple of options. You can play it short, and then I've got somebody who's good at long shots up here. You can play it to either of the posts, in which case I'm confident somebody's going to make a difference. I've got somebody coming from the top of the box that is just athletic and has a chance to make some sort of play, and they're intelligent and whatever. And then I've got somebody marking the keeper. Typically, this is just a short guy, just somebody to get in the way to try and make it easier for some sort of scrap. And give everybody a pretty solid chance at maybe scoring a goal here. I kind of give the taker some impetus to make a decision what they think is best for the team in the moment, and it has worked out. This brings us back to the takers. Takers that I need to take care of. Now, on free kicks, I'm all for clicking the quick pick and just assembling a couple of people. But you need to be careful when you're setting up your corners, because you just set up your corner. You need to pick people that are not going to be running in one of those particular spots. Like if I took somebody that was attacking the near post and all of a sudden had them taking the corner just because they were the highest rated corner taker, well, then that's going to take away a lot more than just going for a 14 instead of a 15 taking the corner. I'm going to lose my main goal scoring thread. So you go back to your corner and you figure out who you can afford to lose. And they're still going to be pretty good at playing the corner kick. So if this is my starting 11, which is actually not, you want maybe Ayrton Rojas. Maybe Andres Silva. And I know for a fact already that Andres Silva is actually a really good corner taker. He's a 13 on the corners. So from the left side and from the right side, Andres Silva is going to take it. But since Andres Silva has just left foot only on, like it's something he just puts on in the morning, Zealand. He's left foot only in his usage of his feet, which means you probably want a right-footed person playing the ball from the left side, because then that ball will also be an in-swinger, and I am all team in-swinger. So let's go Yarlin Estrada, because I've got him doing nothing also. Then for the free kicks, I just want to send one or two more people to go forward, and on the throw-ins, you want to attack the posts if you possibly can, if you've got someone with a long, flat bullet throw. If not, you want to try and drop someone off short, and then they can get on the ball and swing it in. You're essentially setting it up like a short corner. One last thing, though, is something that I just tend to always forget and will be evidenced by the fact that I haven't even said it here, is you have 4 different types of free kicks that you want to get set up. Another question I get asked is how high and long throw should you set that person to just be your all-time long throw taker? I typically would say 14 or 15. Because a person with 11 or 12 that doesn't have long, flat bullet throw as a player trait is really just going to be throwing it short and running back to wherever the hell they came from. So you're just going to end up dragging them out of position anyways. But that's it. Those are your options. I have gone through in excruciating detail your 3 best options for corner. You can focus on one player, give a few players an opportunity to make a play, and now I will leave you with a few bits of knowledge that will help you from letting this get screwed up in the future. Now, I told you you can save your routines and then move them to different tactics, or save all routines, then you load them up in a different tactic. What will happen throughout the course of the game, though, as you make substitutions and you switch tactics, is the players are going to get all jumbled around. So especially in big matches, you want to make sure that after you make a change, maybe that person is all of a sudden a corner taker, but you also have that position attacking a post. You want to make sure that you're able to switch those things around. Now, even I do not do this in every match because you can only make so many changes, and usually you're going to end up in a more or less like-for-like situation in the switch. But if you're making wholesale changes, it will completely blow up your set pieces, both offensively and defensively, in particular on the corners. So you'll want to go back in there and just kind of polish it up a minute or two and make sure that you're doing exactly what you should be doing and you want your team to be doing in the first place. Because by far the number one killer on set pieces is changes during a match that just drag people wildly out of position. And I've accidentally had no one back on corners before and lost a match because of it. So I'm helping you avoid that mistake. Set piece tweaking saves lives. But thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please do hit the like button and you can subscribe to the channel as well. Again, my name is Zealand. I will see you on Twitch, Twitter, Instagram, and whatever else you feel like messaging me on to answer all of your questions or in the comments, of course. And I'll see you soon on the next video, which will be Wednesday. Reese?
Look at this.
Makes the save.
Not only that, he parries it out brilliantly. I mean, he could not have played this any better.
He saves the first one from Firmino with a boot.